been looking at linear equalization in the transmitter and receiver. So, there is some transmit equalizer and then the channel, then the receive equalizer. The idea is, I mean, you can use one or both. So, the idea is to flatten the overall response. The channel has a low pass response, the transmit and receive equalizers give you a high pass response, and the net result is a flat one. But like I said, this receive equalization, it is used and it is basically a continuous time linear equalizer, usually abbreviated to CTLE. Now, this is not very sophisticated in terms of its transfer function, right. So, it is just a simple 0 pole realization, which gives you a high frequency boost. High frequency meaning around fs by 2. So, it raises the overall gain. Okay. Now, the advantage is that, of course, it is independent of the clock and data recovery circuit and so on, and you can have some gain in this. But this high frequency boost also amplifies high frequency noise and crosstalk. Okay. On the transmitter side, typically what is done is this semi-digital FIR realization. Because the inputs are bits, you delay them using flip-flops and you realize weighted summation using, let us say if you are using a current mode transmitter, that is a current driving transmitter, you have multiple differential pairs weighted by different bias currents, which add to the same two nodes to give you the equalized output. Okay. So, this now can have a better controlled response, right. In the continuous time linear equalizer in the receiver, you just have 1 plus s by z 1 by 1 plus s by p 1. You can only change z 1 around to get you the boost, whereas here you can have multiple taps with different weights and things like that. Okay. But as we saw, the disadvantages, if the transmit output is voltage limited, which is always the case in IC type realizations, right. There will be a voltage limitation, then the DC gain has to be reduced as equalization tap weights increase. I will explain again. Yesterday we discussed this. I will explain again what this means. Basically, this, the transmit digital equalizer, this is discrete time and it can be represented in the Z domain, and we have something like, this is for the precursor equalization. Okay. Now, if you have a low pass channel, H minus 1, H 1, H 2 in the equalizer, they are negative. Why is this? What's the intuition behind this? I mean, let's consider only, let's say, two taps. H naught plus H 1 Z inverse. Why is H 1 negative for the equalizer if the channel is low pass? Yeah, so in that we have seen, I mean, by trying to make the response 0, so if the first tap in the first post cursor tap in the channel is positive, this has to be negative, ok. Now, let us imagine this sequence, right. So, let us say the input to this is a series of minus 1 symbols followed by series of plus 1 symbols. This is what the transmitted bits should be, ok. Now, if you have this equalization with H 1 less than 0, what will this look like? Imagine that you have a long string of zeros or minus 1s followed by a long string of 1s. So, what will that look like? The time domain pattern. No, no, this is just the equalizer, that is all. Yeah. So, let us assume that this corresponds to no equalization, ok. This is the transmitter output with no equalization, ok. When you have no equalization, you can say that the transmitter transfer function is just H naught, ok. There is no equalization at all, there is just that tap. And then I have a two tap equalizer, which is H naught plus H 1 Z inverse, with H 1 being negative. What does the transmitter output look like? Yeah. So, basically you can see that it is H naught plus H 1 times Z inverse, ok. So, when you have a series of consecutive minus 1s, what will the value be? The values will all be identical, but what will the values be? So, remember here it will be, this will be minus H naught, this will be plus H naught. So, what will be the values here when you have a series of minus 1s? Yeah. So, this will be minus H naught plus H 1, ok. And what happens at the transition? So, it will jump to H naught plus H 1, because if you look here, the current bit is plus 1, the previous bit is minus 1. So, it is H naught plus H 1, which is negative, times minus 1. So, this will actually be more than H naught, ok. And what happens after that? So, actually this is I think I wrote this wrongly. This is just minus H naught minus H 1. H 1 itself is negative, ok. So, this value will be the magnitude of this will be less than the magnitude of H naught, ok. So, what happens after this? H naught plus H 1, yeah. So, this it jumps to H naught minus H 1. H 1 is negative. So, this is more than H naught, and then it jumps back to H naught plus H 1, ok. So, this is basically what an equalizer does, right. It emphasizes the transitions, because the channel is low pass, the equalizer is high pass. So, around the transitions it gives you a larger jump. And what is the, again the intuition behind it is easy, right. So, for instance, if you did not have any equalization, you would just have a step, right. So, then the output of the channel would be like this up to this point, and then it will slowly rise up. That is the problem. Now, what is this equalization doing? First, the initial part of the step is larger, ok. So, it will start rising as though it had to go there, okay. But on the other hand, soon after the first symbol, the value reduces. So, it actually does something like this. It does this and does that and does that, okay. So, it gets there faster. Because the low pass is sluggish, what you do is when you have to make a transition, if you just feed it to the low pass filter, it does it very slowly. So, you give a much larger step so that you start aiming higher and then you come back to the normal one. That is what equalization does, right. That is an easy time domain intuition of what equalization is. In the frequency domain, it is very clear the low pass is being cancelled by the high pass. In time domain, basically the low pass makes the response sluggish. So, you have to emphasize the transitions, okay. Now, in this case, I have only one post-cursor value. So, if I had precursor also, you would have a jump to a negative value before the transition and then jump to a larger value, okay. That is, you would see instead of jump like this, the equalized jump with a precursor tap would look like that, because you have to have a jump before, right, for precursor case. And then with multiple taps, it could look like this, essentially something high pass, right. So, it kind of jumps this way and that way, so that it makes the responses faster, or it could be like that, okay. That is, you do not drop immediately to the DC level, but you have another step and then you drop to the DC level. So, that is what happens, okay. So, it makes the step values larger, right. Any questions about this? The way I like to think about it is essentially because the low pass is so slow, you get it to aim higher before you let it settle to the right level, okay. Now, what is the problem with the transmit equalizer? I will, like I said, let me assume that the bits are xn and these go to the transmit equalizer and the output bits are yn, okay. This is still the input to the channel. These are basically the transmitter output values, okay. I should not say bits, they are output values. So, let us say the xn are plus minus 1. We know that yn is just the convolution, right, over k. Now, what is the DC gain of this filter? What is the DC gain of a digital filter, a digital FIR filter? Summation of the taps, that is all. If you have to have, you should have z equals 1, that is DC, right. So, DC gain is summation h of k, okay. Now, what is the maximum value of this? This we have discussed many times now. So, this is summation of absolute value of h of k, okay. Now, in a high pass equalizer, the taps next to the cursor, the several taps will be negative. So, this will be more than that for sure, right, because here h 0 is positive and other things are negative. So, this net thing will be smaller than h 0, whereas this will be more than h 0, okay. So, if the transmitter output is voltage limited, this is what is limited, okay. So, clearly that means that you have to scale down the values of every tap, okay. If you scale down the values of every tap, the frequency response does not change, okay. It is only the entire gain that changes, right. The equalization does not change, it is just the amplitude of the signal that changes, that is all. So, if you have to restrict the output amplitude, you have to have a certain value of h 0. So, that means that the DC gain reduces compared to having no equalization. So, if you add more and more equalization, That is more and more equalization, meaning you could be adding more and more taps, or you could also be making the value of each tap larger, right? So if the channel response is very broad, it covers many symbols. So the pre and post cursor ISI could be as big as the cursor itself. So that means that the, in the equalizer also, the pre and post cursor taps have to be as large as the cursor, okay? So as you make the tap magnitude larger or add more taps, you will have to reduce the reduce H0 so that the whole thing can be accommodated within the given limit. Is this okay? Any questions about this? Is it clear how the limitation comes about? So basically what I mean is the following. So if you had no equalization, this would be H of 0. If you had one tap equalization, this would have to be H of 0 minus H of 1. I am assuming H of 1 is negative. Okay? So that means that H of 0 would be here, right? So this would be H of 0, and the DC gain. What is the DC gain now? Basically, if you have a set of consecutive identical digits, you will get a certain steady state value in the at the transmitter output, okay. After a while, after the around the transition, you have the effect of the equalizer. So now, I mean few bits after that, depending on the length of the equalizer, you will have a steady state. That is related to DC gain, right, by definition. I mean, if you apply a constant, the steady state that you see at the output of the filter is the DC gain times the input value. So that will become H 0 plus H 1. Okay. So basically you have a reduction in gain for the same maximum limit. Okay. So if you had, let's say this to be originally H0 was, let's say I'll give it dimensions of voltage 400 millivolts. So this means that for a plus 1 I was transmitting plus 400 millivolts. For a minus 1, I was transmitting minus 400 millivolts, okay. Now, I need to accommodate this H1, which is let us say half of H0, okay. So, now H0 itself will become 400 millivolts by 1.5, okay. So, that is about 267 millivolts, and then this H0 plus H1 will be this minus 133. So, how much is that? Sorry, this divided by 1.5, right? 400 minus 267. Is this correct? 400 millivolts by 1.5 is 266 millivolts, right? So, H1 is 133, and H0 plus H1 will just be another 133 millivolts, okay. So, that means that if I had a string of 1s, originally I was transmitting 400 millivolts, now I will be transmitting only 133 millivolts, okay. So, it is a big reduction in the signal, okay. This also, because you have a certain, let us say we assume that a given noise is added at the receiver input. So, clearly your bit error ratio will become worse because of this, okay. It is supposed to, equalization is supposed to make it better. So, it will make it better by making the eye opening larger, but the amplitude that you see in the middle of the eye itself is smaller. It is a nice and open eye, but a smaller eye, okay. So, at some point this will start hurting you. You cannot have arbitrary amount of equalization in the transmitter also. Is this okay? Any questions about any of this? So, both receiver and transmitter equalization, if you try to equalize too much, what happens is in the receiver stuff, it is not the gain issue, but it will amplify the noise too much. And in the transmitter, basically with a given output limit on the transmitter voltage, you will end up reducing the amplitude that you can transmit, okay. So, either way there is a limitation. Any questions about any of this? So now let's look at what happens to crosstalk. So I have the input signal x of n. This goes through the transmitter and then a channel which I will, the transfer function I will denote as HCH, and then the receiver HRX. Okay. Now I have another transmitter. Now a reasonable assumption is that it also uses an equalizer, right? We will have like a whole bunch of transmitters and receivers together, everything will be using equalization. So, this is the output of the second transmitter, and now you do not want this, but this will get added to the input of the first receiver in some way. This could be near end, far end, whatever. Okay. So, I need to show the transfer function here. I will call it HXT, that is the crosstalk. Okay. That could be near end crosstalk, far end crosstalk, whatever it is, you just find the transfer function from this transmitter to that receiver. Okay. So, now let me call this x 1 and this is x 2. The transfer function from x 1 to the output, what is it? It is HTX times HTS times HRX. Okay. And the transfer function from crosstalk to the output, what is that? HTX times HXT times HRX. Okay. I have assumed that the transmitter uses the same equalizer in the two cases, which is a reasonable assumption. If you have an array of transmitters, there is they could be expected to use the same type of equalization. Okay. So, now you can see it does not matter whether you distribute the equalization in the transmitter or the receiver, okay, because it just appears as a product, right. The desired one, the channel response is multiplied by HTX times HRX, it is just a product. So, you can put some of the equalization in the receiver, some in the transmitter. Okay. So, but it does not matter how you distribute it, because I mean sometimes there is some confusion about whether the receive equalization does not change gain, whereas the transmit equalization changes gain and so on. But at least under our assumption that the crosstalk transmitter also uses the same equalizer, you will get this HTX times HRX there as well. Okay. So, it does not matter what you, how you distribute it, it is only the total amount of equalization that matters. Is this okay? And like I said, the equalizer essentially the frequency domain, what it is trying to do is to boost up the magnitude at near fs by 2. Okay, that is the role of the equalizer. And crosstalk also tends to be higher only at high frequencies, because crosstalk is because of parasitic capacitive and inductive coupling. It does not have anything at DC and eventually everything is low pass. So, it typically has a band pass type behavior. So, that also becomes high at some medium frequency. So, this equalization actually makes the crosstalk worse, right. So, that is why even if you can implement a huge amount of equalization like this, it is probably not a good idea, because crosstalk may limit the bit error rate. Yeah. Something, I mean eventually there will be some limitation of but even then I mean there will be some band limiting somewhere. So, it is true, like basically I do not know if I have pictures to show. So, the far end stuff will be a little bit milder, the near end stuff could be something like that. Okay. But eventually either in the receiver or somewhere there will be some parasitic low pass type effect as well. Okay. So, yeah, if you do assume something like this. So, let us say you use a very simple model, this is channel 1, it is just a resistor and a capacitor, we use a lump model. Channel 2, we also use just a resistor, I mean a lumped resistor and a capacitor, and then you assume that the crosstalk is like this. In this case, you can see it is just a ratio of capacitors, right. So at high frequencies the gain will become flat and remain constant, but this is not reality, everything is distributed, so it will eventually become low pass. And like I said, what happens is that you have the eye diagram that you get for your signal. I mean, the curves I am drawing are basically the closed parts of that, right. So, the open part is over here, this is the open part of the eye, ok. So, let us say this is the result of whatever equalization you have put in the transmitter and the receiver and the channel response, ok. Now, if you look at the eye diagram of the crosstalk signal by itself, first of all, because the frequencies may be different, it will just look like a band, ok. The eye diagram of the crosstalk, it will just look like a band, because it will have those jumps at the transitions and it may not even be synchronized to this eye diagram. So, the peak can occur anywhere. So, it will just look like this band, ok. So, now this is the desired. This is the crosstalk. Now, let us say our sampling incident is there for the CDR has determined that to be the sampling incident. Now, without crosstalk, this would have been the amplitude of the eye. Now, with crosstalk, what happens? Whatever height is here, that should be subtracted from that one, ok. So, that becomes the amplitude of the eye. So, it is like reducing the amplitude further. Now, it is not all, I mean, it also depends on the crosstalk bit distribution, but this can happen, right. So, the amplitude, if you look at the worst case eye type scenario, then whatever you get from the desired channel minus the peak to peak value of the crosstalk is what you would have as the worst case IO, ok. Which one? No, so if I assume a near end crosstalk scenario, ok. So, this transmitter may have a slightly different frequency from that transmitter, ok. Now, I am assuming that this eye diagram is drawn with this being one period of the desired signal, desired transmitter, ok. Now, that is not exactly the same as one period of the crosstalk signal. I am drawing both of them with the same period. Now, if the actual period is slightly different from the period you choose for the eye diagram, what happens is sometimes the peak of this will be here, sometimes it will be there, sometimes it will be there, it will slide all over the place. So, the whole thing will look like just a smear, ok. Is that ok? Even otherwise, I mean, we cannot really time the crosstalk peaks, it could well be in the middle where you want to sample the data, ok. Any questions here? Now, one way to try and remove the crosstalk, this is viable typically if for near end crosstalk. So, let us say you have a transmitter, channel and a receiver. And you have a transmitter going in the other direction, and this also couples to that. And let us say these are part of the same chip. If it is part of the same chip, then it is easy, in the sense you know what the transmitted signal is, ok. So, perhaps you could model the crosstalk channel, and you have this HXT here or some model of it, and subtract it off, ok. So, this is done sometimes, especially in Ethernet it is done, because you have 4 pairs of wires which are basically next to each other throughout their length, and the length is quite long, length is quite a bit, it can be up to 110 meters or something. So, the crosstalk is very significant, ok. So, there you in the chip you have both the transmitter and the receiver, but the transmitted stuff it goes through some filter which is supposed to model the crosstalk and then it cancels it off, ok. One thing I have not addressed which I will come to soon is what is known as adaptation. We do not know the transfer function of any of these things, either the channel or the crosstalk. We have to actually measure it and then make sure that we use the right kind of filter, but it is done. But But this may become very complicated in some cases. So, in very high frequency links, I have not seen this done, but it can be in principle done. Okay. Any questions here? So, what is a popular alternative in high speed systems to these shortcomings, I mean in response to the shortcomings of linear equalization? It is known as a decision feedback equalizer. Okay. So, the principle is quite simple. So, let me assume that the transmitter is just sending plus or minus 1s. Okay. So, maybe I will call the signal x of n and this is either plus or minus 1. Okay. And this is the channel, and let us say it has an impulse response, the channel pulse response, the equivalent discrete time impulse response is h naught plus h 1 z inverse. I will consider two taps. This can be extended to any number of taps. This is now the channel impulse response. Again, I indulged in some notation abuse. I used the same h for the transmitter earlier, but now it is the channel. So, h naught and h 1 will be like this. Now, we already saw that if you use a linear equalizer of the type h naught minus h 1 z inverse, it will either boost the noise or it will reduce the transmitted signal amplitude. Now, there is another like seemingly easy way to fix this. So, what does this give you after all? Here you get x of n, h naught x of n plus h 1 x of n minus 1, right? That is basically what it is. Now, let us say I somehow knew x of n. Okay. So, I delay it. By 1 and I weight it with h 1 and I subtract it off. Okay. Obviously, what will I get at the output? What am I going to get at the output? H naught x of n. Basically, there is no inter symbol interference. Will this work? Do you see any problems here? I mean, this seems like very easy, right? I mean, that is the point. I mean, the transmitter is here. So, x of n is known here. This is the receiver. If we already knew x of n, we would not have to build anything else, right? So, but what do you think might be the solution here? What is the goal of the receiver actually? To find x of n basically. So, what you do is the following. We have the channel response and finally, in the receiver there is some decision slicer. Okay. The transmitter is sending x of n. If everything is working correctly, what is the signal here? What is the signal at the output of the slicer? X of n. It should be the same as the transmitted signal. Okay. So, what you do is the following. Here we will be getting h naught x of n plus h 1 x of n minus 1. Okay. Now, whatever we do here, assuming everything is working correctly, at this point I have recovered x of n. Okay. So, what I do is I take this, I delay this by 1 sample and weight it by h 1 and subtract it from there. Okay. Is this fine? So, now somehow if I assume that initially we receive one bit correctly, then this feedback will be correct, and after that at this point I will keep getting S naught x of n, and if I make a decision on this I will get x of n, and that is all that is there. Okay. Is this okay? And this is known as decision feedback equalization. Okay. So, you make the decisions and assuming they were correct and assuming you know the channel impulse response H 1, H 2, etcetera, you can find exactly what the ISI is, what the contribution of the ISI is, right. So, you just compute it and subtract it off from the input. Okay. Do you foresee any problems here? Timing, yeah, timing recovery has to be done. Basically, first of all, for this decision to be correct, this clock has to come from a clock and data recovery circuit. Okay. So, that is there. So, the timing has to start working before any of these things work, because obviously, this is based on decisions and decisions have to be correct. Okay. Anything else? Yeah. So, one possibility in this does not happen very often, but the possibility is what is known as error propagation. Okay. So, let us say you make a wrong decision once and then that basically gives you this ISI in the wrong polarity, right. Instead of adding it will subtract and so on. So, the next decision also could be wrong and because of that the next one could be wrong and so on. So, that is known as error propagation, that is definitely a possibility with the decision feedback equalizer, but once the eye is open to a certain extent, typically you get a few decisions, correct decisions, and after that everything works fine. Okay. What advantage does this have compared to linear equalizer? By the way, I mean, do you see the relationship between this and what is this? I have a feedback loop, okay, and in the feedback loop I have a decision slicer. Now, let me consider another feedback loop. I mean, this is also weighted by H 1. I do not have the decision slicer. What is this? What is this block? It's a low pass filter. It is an IR filter. It is low pass or high pass depends on the sign of H 1. Okay. So, it is an IR filter. What is the transfer function? 1 plus H 1 Z inverse. In fact, if H naught is 1, right, if H naught was 1, so if this was 1 plus H 1 Z inverse, this is exactly the type of equalizer that would completely equalize it, right. Okay. But this is a linear system, whereas this is a nonlinear system, there is a slicer in the middle. So, what is it? I mean, I said, okay, the linear equalizers have some disadvantages. How does this help now? What is good about this? What did I say was the problem with receiver equalizer, the linear equalizer? What happens in this case? So, you think about two cases. You have this feedback and you do not have this feedback. Okay. So, what is the noise seen at the input of the decision block? Is there any difference? Noise will be scaled by a factor. So, why will it be reduced? No, that's not the feedback loop. See, the feedback loop has a delay of one cycle. It cannot be doing anything to correct things within that cycle. So, okay. There is a certain amount of noise here at the input of the slicer. What will be the noise at the output of the slicer? So what will be the noise? There will be no noise, zero, right? Because the slicer will produce either plus 1 or minus 1, there is no noise. The input may have a signal, some value, let us say 200 millivolts plus some 1 millivolt of noise. But the output may be, the output will be clipped to let us say 200 millivolts, it will not have any noise. So, the difference between this linear feedback and this nonlinear feedback is that in the linear feedback case, this is not the type of equalizer we made, but in every linear equalizer you will have this type of linear circuitry. So, the noise from here, it appears through this and it goes there, it gets added up and there will be noise boosting at high frequencies. Clearly, you see that at fs by 2 means at fs by 2 there will be noise boosting if you calculate the transfer function. Okay? Whereas, here any noise here does not result in a noise in the decision because you already made the decision. So, the feedback part does not have any noise. Now, in implementation this waiting block H1 could have some noise, but let us ignore that. So, there is no noise. So, there is no high frequency noise amplification with the decision feedback equalizer, that is actually the greatest virtue. So, whatever value of the tap size you choose, you do not have any noise amplification. Okay? So, this is a big advantage compared to linear equalizer. Is this okay? The main thing is all filters are weighted summations basically, that is all, right? After all, I mean especially in the digital filter, it is very easy to see this. What is the FIR digital filter or even an IR digital filter? Basically, you have weighted summation of a number of signals. Now, if the input has noise, what are you weighting and summing? Basically, delayed versions of the input or output. So, that will also have noise. So, everything will get added up and then you will have some transfer function for the noise. If the equalizer provides a boosting type transfer function, where you have the boost, you will also have noise amplification. Whereas, here the point is it is also a weighted summation, but weighted summation of what? The input will have some noise, but the rest of the stuff are based on decisions already made which has zero noise. Okay, so what you are adding to that does not have any noise. So, there is no noise amplification like in the linear case. So, the easiest way to visualize that is to visualize these two blocks, okay, with the slicer in the path and without the slicer in the feedback loop. Without the slicer you will have noise going through over and over, whereas without the, I mean with the slicer you do not have that. Okay? Any questions? So, this DFE is very powerful and it is used, actually it is used with lots of taps. Okay? You do not typically make the transmit equalizer also with that many taps, but this one you make with a lot of taps because you can cancel a lot of inter-symbol interference without this noise penalty. Okay? So, it is common to have let us say 7-tap equalizer, 7-tap decision feedback equalizer at high frequencies also. But what is the disadvantage of this? Is there something that this cannot do at all? That your transmit equalizer can do and the receive linear equalizer also can do. So, let us say the channel pulse response is like this. I mean this thing seems extremely good, right? Somehow if you get it started off, it looks like it can completely kill the ISI. Precursor it cannot do, because you can make the decision and you can correct the effect of ISI for the symbols that come afterwards. Okay? So, it can only correct postcursor ISI, it cannot correct precursor ISI at all. So, that is why you cannot completely get rid of the transmit and receive equalizers. Frequently you do have some receive linear equalizer or the transmit linear equalizer. Okay? it also doesn't have this gain issues that is there in the transmit equalizer, right? Transmit output amplitude is fixed, so you have to go on reducing the main cursor amplitude if you want to put more and more taps. Here that's not the case. But can correct only post cursor ISI, right? And the other thing is, this requires CDR to be working. The CDR has to be working, otherwise you will not be sampling at the right point and making the right decisions. Now, that can be a tricky one, because the CDR also needs a somewhat open eye for it to start working, okay? Because if the CDR cannot detect any symbols at all, if the eye is completely closed, then the CDR itself will not converge. So, there is the chicken and egg problem, but typically the CDR can start converging for bitter rate values that are much higher than what you need from these communication systems, okay? So, if the bitter rate, if the eye is such that the bitter rate is, let's say, 10 to the minus 3 or something, the CDR will easily converge, okay? So, the tricky part is that the open eye will be here, right, after you remove the ISI. So, the CDR has to work from this signal. This is the signal that has to be sent to the CDR. This is also one of the reasons why you typically have some receive equalization, that continuous time equalization. It doesn't do a great job, but it's independent of all these things, right? It simply inverts the channel frequency response and gives you an eye that is slightly more open than what is at the output of the channel. So, that will get the, once the CDR starts working, all these other things can take over and then you can do basically much better ISI correction. And of course, you also need the continuous time equalizer so that you can cancel the precursor ISI, okay? Any questions about any of this? This is done in the receiver. No, no, in the transmitter there is no question of decisions, right? Ah, that is, that becomes a basically a feed forward equalizer. I mean, that is the equalizer, right? I mean, in the transmitter, if you realize this equalizer, that's basically what it is, that's all, okay? Which one? No, no, yeah, not precursor, no, no, you have to see, in the impulse response, these are the precursor and the green ones are the post cursor, okay? In the convolution, how do you do convolution? I mean, one way of thinking about it is, you flip this and then slide it with your input pattern and then multiply and add, okay? So, if this is the current bit, if the current bit is aligned with the cursor, okay, the green ones will multiply the bits that come afterwards, okay, the blue ones will affect the bits that come before, okay. So, you cannot correct anything that came before, you can only, the effect of the current bit on the future bits you can correct, okay, because you can compute the effect and next, when the next bit comes in, you can correct for the effect of that. No, no, whatever it is. So, let us say this is time instant 0. So, this will be x of 0, the input at time instant 0. So, this will be at time instant 1, this will be at time instant minus 1. So, at time 0, I know the value of x of 0, okay. Now, I cannot go back to time minus 1 and correct this x of 0 times h of minus 1 would have affected the previous bit. But how do I go back and correct it? I can't do that, okay? But x of 0 times h 1 will affect the next bit. So, I will decide on x of 0, I will compute x of 0 times h 1 and subtract it from the next one. That is why I have z inverse and correct the next bit, okay? So, I can only, I mean, I can compute the, I can make the decision now, and let us say that is x of 0, and whatever effect it has on the bits that come later, I can compute and correct. Whatever effect it already had on bits that came before, I can't do anything because I already made the decision on the previous bits. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, it will be basically the complete HTX times the channel times the receiver. Okay. Basically, it is the at the transmitter you imagine transmitting a 1. Okay. You will get some response at this point, that is HCH, I mean, or H whatever, I mean you can call it whatever you want, but everything will contribute to the overall response. I mean, I have divided it as the transmitter, the channel and the receiver, but of course, the interconnection between the channel and the transmitter or the receiver will also have an effect. You can club it either with the transmitter or with the channel and so on. Okay. So, that is why you need adaptation here, I mean we do will not know what it is. We have to determine the weight of this H1, H2, etcetera. I mean, I showed only one, but I can also do more. Okay, so I can have more delays, and then I have H1, H2, and so on. So I have multiple tabs, so I can correct all of these things: H1, H2, H3. Is this okay? So think about these things. We'll continue.